I think we're there. I think we're still there. And Dr. G thinks that, and he works with some of the best teams in the world. You see him, you know, working with Phelps when he's got the 8 gold medals and taking lactate samples. You should have been there taking nutrition samples, whatever, or blood samples. Yeah. But maybe that's the next step.
Right.
So let's say you walk in September. You have to give them some general thing as part of your CGI. And you give everyone pretty much in a group that's going to go, say, 20,000 meters that week, the same nutritional guidance. Mm-hmm. This is about how many calories you should take in. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to keep those numbers for me in this little Excel interactive spreadsheet you and I can devise. Mm-hmm. Right now, if we want to, but by the next time everybody sees us, right?
Yeah.
We give a little thing and we say, okay, so you fill this out for us. Mm-hmm. And you do that for the first couple of weeks. Maybe there's a psychological thing. You say, how did you feel? Coming into practice, coming out of practice? How did you sleep? Was it easy to go to sleep? Right. What are your other stresses? Because maybe that affects how we're going to tell them to eat and that kind of thing.
Sure.
Yeah. Male or female, maybe a couple little things, right, that we do in the algorithm. But then we also say, okay, you were supposed to go 20,000 or 20,000. Did you miss a practice? I mean, is there anything in there that throws us off?
Right.
But in general, you and I could maybe with CGI and go, okay, we've got 20 athletes and 15 of them are doing great. What's the anomaly in the five? Or 15 are doing pretty average. What's the anomaly in the five that are doing so much better in terms of their nutrition, maybe only with given that all the other science is sort of, you know, locked in?
Yeah.
Not easy, but with a large enough end, don't you think we'd be able to start to get some real habit?
I definitely think so. Yeah, I definitely do. Because that's how you can see patterns.
Yeah.
And that's how you can make connections between nutrition and performance.
So I think I can convince some coaches to do this if you want to help me write this up.
Yeah, I would love that. And then what you can do is say that's the first 2 months, did you say, of the season, of the training periodization season. And then when we get into the build phase, maybe we can just increase those calories 10 to 20% or whatever we figure out that we need to, and then do the same, gain the same feedback from those swimmers and say, okay, did you feel any better? Did you go any faster? Did you sleep any better? All those variables. And find the feedback from there. Same thing with taper, same thing with racing. That would be really interesting.
Yeah, I think by taper, you'd probably have some real clues as to what to tell this person to eat. You know,
I think
you'd have some real hints for the coach, for the team, for the parents. Now, I work one-on-one a lot. So, in telling a parent, okay, it's going to be September. This is your shopping list.
Mm-hmm.
So can you give me one of those? Can you give me a shopping list that would make some sense without being crazy financially? In fact, you know, both of us are probably on some kind of a budget, right? We're not like wealthy. We don't have Dara Torres having a nutritionist living in her house, right?
Right, that would be nice.
She did that for, remember, I don't know if she knew that. She did that for a year, you know, had a nutritionist.
I did, I read that once, yeah. That's
crazy. But, and how wonderful that must have been, you know? But that's not what we're saying. We're saying that, okay, based upon what you could buy, based upon what you could tell your athlete. I mean, I've got one in my house that's not really an athlete, but she eats horribly and I don't know what to do with her. She hates most vegetables. You know, we force her to eat broccoli, but it's like, you know, broccoli, and that's all day. That's all day. That's my daughter. So I can understand if there's going to be parents that are going to say, hey, I can't do this. However, there's a much greater motivation once a kid gets to even junior Olympics and a local junior Olympic thing. When the kid is really motivated, you might be able to get them to do some things that otherwise they don't like. Or maybe you and I can figure out how to, you know, make it more palatable and still it's getting the calories in, you know. But my daughter took off today for the camp. Her stomach was bothering her and she ate she's eating a beef stick. That's it.
Okay.
It's embarrassing, but there it is.
No, it's more common than you think.
Oh, yeah.
Then there's so many factors that go into that. You know, everyone's taste buds are different. Everyone's sensitivity stomach wise is different. A lot of it is just exposure, believe it or not. How old is your daughter?
She's 13 and a junior in college. So she's not an idiot. And she's a biology major.
So, really? So she has some knowledge. Yes.
Yeah. And well, and she, you know, she wants to be a paleontologist, and those things are dead. So they don't have nutritional needs. I don't know what it is in her head, but it's not just her head. It's just habitual and whatever. And part of it is, any parent knows this, if I say it, it's one thing. If you say it, Jennifer, it's another thing. Yeah. You're a professor, it will make a difference. And we already know that. She does things at school that she doesn't do here. And yet she was very effective as a homeschooled kid, but you know, it's different. So yes. this is where you can have this amazing impact across the nation, maybe across the world, in saying that, you know, we've been doing this. Mm-hmm. And this team last year, oh, by the way, and there's some stuff that's hard to get because USA Swimming is a pain in the neck to me about getting me all the data. But you can go to any individual swimmer, or if you're the coach of the team, you can go to the whole team. And mm-hmm. you can actually start to graph. I did this for Ron and live. I did it live on a Zoom like this. Oh, yeah. We went into his swimmers and we looked at their progress. There's a thing called, you can look at their best times. And then there's this thing over there, you can look at progress, and you click on progress and it shows over the years how much they've been improving over the years. So what I did was I copied that, actually physically, you know, copied it and pasted it into Excel. And I already, within Excel, I had it do that thing I just said about the percentage. Well, that was drop off rate, and then percentage improvement. And okay. His goal is to have a 6% improvement, but live, I showed him they weren't hitting 6%. Now they were way ahead of the rest of the teams.
Okay.
So that said something,
right?
But if you and I have that kind of data, then we work with a team that actually treats you seriously.
Yeah.
And that team improves at even a 1%, even a 0.5% across the team. That's insanely different. You know how much you win the 50 by.
Yeah. You
know? So, and I don't know what they're doing right about nutrition, but we need to maybe find out. Is Australia has a girl, Titmus, who unshaved, according to them, just set the world record in the 400 free.
Really?
Beating our girl that supposedly out-trains anyone. And I believe that about Katie.
Yeah.
And of course is doing some great things. Now, Katie would love to have that 0.5%. And maybe she's already doing everything she can do and has a nutritionist in Florida and all that.
Yeah.
But maybe not. Maybe it's a 0.5%. I think once you catch fire, you just better make sure you're right. Because you're going to get, you know what I mean? And it's going to be that thing where you're not wrong. You're never wrong because you're willing to adapt to the individual swimmer. Mm-hmm. That, maybe they need more vitamin D or less or whatever.
Yeah. Right.
And if they really give you trouble, you say, now you got to do blood work.
Right. Yeah. And if, you know, sometimes what it comes down to is you can make specific changes in a swimmer's lifestyle and they only get so far, right? And that's when you dive deeper for the blood work. Cause then you're like, something's not right here. You're doing everything right and you're not improving, or you're improving, but not to the amount that we want you to improve, right? Not to the degree that we want you to improve. So then we go, there must be something else. And that's when you dive deeper and almost always we'll find something like a vitamin D deficiency or an iron deficiency or something else that's going on, or an intolerance to something. And that is the opens up the bigger picture. So then we really know what's going on. But until you get there, you kind of just, the general recommendations really work for most athletes. And it's a very small percentage that there's something else deeper going on.
Okay. All right. Well, that's good. So in general, we'd make a really general improvement. And then I was just kind of brainstorming now is that, you know, when they go, when Ron brings his swimmers for 3 weeks, or I think it was 5 weeks, to the Olympic Training Center in Colorado Springs. Mm-hmm. He also has Gennadius, who is actually doing some blood work. I think he's only looking at lactate and maybe some other things like that, the waste products.
Interesting.
But what if we started, you know, now we brought you in, let's say we brought you personally in, do you have enough science background to be able to do the blood work and be able to tell them you yourself without anybody else?
Yeah. Yep.
Oh, that's awesome.
And analyze it. So for sure.
Tell us that, just because people watching this probably don't know, What background is that? What do you need to be able to do that?
Well, really, I'm a registered dietitian, so my training is clinical. So I've worked, and I even worked in a hospital for years too. So I have the medical training, which other, there's nutritionists that are not registered dietitians that don't have that medical training. And then it's the registered dietitians that have the medical training to be able to read blood work, to collect blood work, first of all, and read it and analyze it and give recommendations based on that. We also have training on all conditions, on all medical conditions. So whether you're gluten intolerant or celiac, or you have heart disease in your family, or whatever your medical history is, we have training on that to be able to make dietary recommendations where other just nutritionists don't.
That's so awesome, because, you know, as I think about it, and there's more of you out there, and I know you're special and extraordinary, but it would be good to know that there, if we had a bank of people. But what I'm thinking of, I'm thinking of doing camps. I no longer do the Cal Baptist camp. So we're thinking about putting together our own camps and to bring somebody like you in to actually do that stuff. What would you need? But what would you need? Would you have, can you bring in whatever you need to actually come into a camp and do that? Or do you need a lab?
We need a lab, but there are so many labs around. So wherever your camp would be located, we could just hook up with a lab locally.
Would they be able to get it back to you fast enough? Are they usually pretty good about that? Or because I know when I have blood work done by my doctor, it takes like 2 weeks to get stuff back.
Oh yeah. No, honestly, it's less than 24 hours. And all we would need to do is communicate with the lab and arrange that. So if it was a camp situation, usually the 2 week wait is just because the doctor has so many other people to get back to, and he's seeing patients for half the day. So he's only making calls once every 2 weeks to follow up anyway. So that's the logistics behind that. But
so if you were there and you had everything, if you had everything, like at the training center or AIS or something like that, you could have it. And how fast? I mean, you took blood, and how quickly could you come back to us and talk to us?
I would say the latest 24 hours.
Oh, but I mean, it's not like a couple hours or an hour or something. It's not like by their next meal or something.
Right. Right. Well, you know, it depends on the lab and how quickly their turnover is. And it just depends on the relationship you have and how backloaded they are too, if they're obviously taking blood from other individuals. But it's, in my experience, it's 24 hours.
So that's good. I mean, that's good. And I think the thing I'm kind of bringing up too, and this is a great question if we're doing an interview, which I think we're trying to solve the problems of the world, which I think is a good thing. But this brainstorming, I think, is a really good thing. But the thing I would ask there too is, we're not talking about an instant fix. Oh, you're low on iron, boom, it fixes you next day. Doesn't it take a while for the ferritin to, you know, get, So what would you, are there any instant fixes where somebody's feeling really lousy and by the end of the day, because you've changed their nutrition, they're almost instantly improved? I won't say, you know, 100%, but feeling better.
That's a really good question. There's two things that can instantly fix you. One is hydration. So if somebody's dehydrated, in fact, I just had an athlete this week who was rushed to the emergency room because she was extremely dehydrated. She was a lacrosse player, but an IV will instantly fix you. I don't know if you've had an IV.
Not well, I have, but I don't remember it. Yeah.
I had once when I was pregnant, and I remember it. I'll still remember to this day. It was 20 years ago, but it feels good because you just instantly kind of snap back. Like, you know, you're like really dehydrated and depleted and you just want to sleep, and all of a sudden you're better. So yes, an IV will snap you right back. In fact, they do that on the triathlon course for a lot of dehydrated triathletes, and that'll make them snap back and they can finish their race right away. So that's one. To the same note, sodium can do that too. So it's still underneath the hydration umbrella, but if you are depleted in electrolytes and hence dehydrated, and you supplement with, say, a salt tab or a salt supplement or an electrolyte supplement and water, you can snap back pretty quickly too, within probably 10 to 20 minutes. So those are two quick fixes. The other one is regulating your blood sugar. So if we can get your blood sugar regulated through foods, and that's just through combining different foods at each of your meals, you can get your blood sugar regulated within a couple hours. So 3 to 4 hours, we can re-regulate your blood sugar and you can be back on track, which is pretty cool. You could say, have somebody that just went off the rails this weekend and had, you know, cheeseburgers and fries and whatever, they were at a party, and they can get back to training Monday and feel horrible Monday. By Monday evening, if you clean up their diet, you can be back on track.
So that's a really good point for a parent or an athlete that has trials and finals. And in the trials, you know, maybe they didn't eat breakfast, or maybe they did, or maybe they just been, as you said, trashing their body. And then they come in and they're like, I feel awful, but I really want to win this finals. So you could tell them, no, okay, so let's say that's happened. Okay, it's me and I'm feeling really rotten and it's 11. I'm done with my preliminaries. I'm going to come back at 5. So it gives me a little time to work your magic.
Yeah.
I gotta say this, please answer that question. But also before I forget, I'll write it down, but it'd be rude, which I don't mind. There's this other thing, a nutritionist I watched do it. She was really good. A couple of weeks ago or last week or something. I don't know if I sent her link to you, but she had said that there's a kind of salt that she puts in, not salt, not the regular sodium, but a kind of salt. It was like she wasn't selling it.
Was it base salts? Was it?
I don't know. It was like from some foreign country or something. Some like, you know, I don't know. I'm going to make it up right now, but it was some
Himalayan salt,
some kind of thing like that. It wasn't that, but it was something. I'll look it up. Is that possible? Or is sodium, or maybe there was some potassium or some other kinds of salts, but she said this is way better than Gatorade because there's no sugar and that kind of thing.
Interesting. Yeah. I mean, I agree with her that there's some salt and or electrolyte supplements that have potassium, magnesium, calcium that are better than Gatorade for sure. Cause then you don't have to worry about the sugar highs and the sugar crash. That's amazing for hydration, but I'm just not clear what kind of salt would be better.
I'm not either. I just wanted to bring that up. Okay. Let's just bring that into the discussion. I'm feeling lousy. It's 11 o'clock. And you come in and I call you and I, what do I eat? So what do I do? And you're going to include probably some salt just in case, right?
Yeah. Well, hydration is going to be key because you have to make sure that all the nutrients get to where they need to go. So we have to maximize hydration and that could take an hour or two. You know, everyone's different depending how dehydrated they are. And if we have a couple hours, so finals start at 5 and it's 11. So we have 6 hours, then I would get right on and plan two kind of mini meals, I call them two meals. It doesn't have to be mini, but like two meals timed a few hours apart. Probably for 6 hours, I would time them maybe 2.5 hours apart. So we have enough time before your race to digest them. And making sure in order to regulate your blood sugar, you really need to make sure that each one of those two meals that we're going to take in have a combination of carbohydrate, protein, and a little bit of fat. I will bring the fat down a little bit just because fat takes longer to digest and we want to be ready to dive off the block without a lot of stuff in our stomach. We want it to be absorbed as much as possible and the fat will slow that down. So just a little bit of fat. Protein also slows down digestion, but protein and carbohydrate together will help regulate your blood sugar. So we just want to make sure it's a lean source of protein that we can metabolize a little bit more quickly than higher fat.
Okay, so let's say I'm out of town. I'm at a meet. And I got to do something. I used to do this when I was really good with my own nutrition. I would go to the store. I wouldn't go to the restaurant and I just grab stuff out of the store and I would just eat it. Including raw meat, which at the time I was German. Wow. I always felt strong. I don't know. Maybe it's mental. It's kind of like sparkless water to me. I think sparkless water works well for me, but it's big deal. So you're out of town, probably a restaurant. Tell me what to order.
I would do something really simple and easily to digest. So grilled chicken sandwich with spinach. So we get some nutrients in our spinach and maybe sliced avocado for our healthy fat. So we have our carbohydrates, which is the bread or whatever roll it's on. And for this, since it's right before a race, you don't necessarily need to go whole grain. Most of the times I will say go whole grain because there's more nutrients in it. But even if you went just a white roll, just a regular ciabatta roll, maybe because we want it to be metabolized quickly before our race. So that's the only difference between like regular nutrition recommendations, higher nutrients kind of recommendations, and before a race.
You can almost eat this at Subway. I mean, you really don't have to be in some special restaurant or some Subway would have the avocado and it would have.
I
get the whining of it, but
it's the best option, but it definitely would work. And the other interesting thing to point out is you don't always want to be perfect with your nutrition because as an athlete, you could be somewhere where your options are really limited and say Subway is your only option and you eat Subway and then your stomach could reject it because you haven't had any of that, like preservative, high preservative foods or anything like that. So there is some arguments for not being perfect. I had an athlete that once raced in, I'm going to get the country wrong, in the Middle East somewhere. And the plane was delayed and they didn't land till late. And they finally got there. And the only thing that was open was McDonald's. So and he was like, I haven't eaten McDonald's in 20 years and I don't know what to do. And it was the only option before his race that was going on the next day. So he had to eat. So he had to do McDonald's and it did upset his stomach. So not that I'm saying you should eat McDonald's. I'm just saying like, you do not need to be perfect all the time. Okay. And there's benefits to not being perfect. But that being said, being pretty good most of the time is going to give your body the most nutrition possible. So yeah, so back to your meal. So a good option, say for that first mini meal, would be grilled chicken sandwich on bread, spinach for your nutrients, and sliced avocado for that healthy fat, and will give you a lot of calories slash energy to get through that next 6 hours till your race. That second meal can be a little bit smaller, but the same general recommendations, protein, carbohydrate, and maybe a little bit of fat, depending on what the race is. If it's a distance race, I would say throw some fat in there. If it's a sprint, a 50, I would say probably nix that. You just don't need it. And it would take longer to digest. So for that example, I would do Greek yogurt with sliced bananas, sliced strawberries, and some sliced almonds on top.
Okay.
Or even maybe a little bit of granola on top.
Okay. Now granola will have some sugar. You're not worried about that?
I choose low sugar granola. I also really, for the most part, make my own granolas, which doesn't have a lot of sugar, maybe a little honey just to sweeten it, but not a ton of sugar and not a ton of fat either. There's a lot of granolas out there that are high in fat, but you know, just processed granolas. So you want to really be knowledgeable about what brands to buy so that they're lower in sugar and lower in fat.
I was blessed to stay at Allison Wagner's house when she was the world record holder in the 200 meter IM. And she was, cool. She was getting ready. She was still in high school. So I stayed at her house and then I got to watch her workout and I was going to maybe take over the Florida aquatic team. And they were interviewing me. They flew me there and I stayed at her house and that was kind of impressive. But here's the funny thing is she was, I'm going to say 16, maybe she was 17, making her own bread.
Wow.
She was going to nationals in a few days, making her own bread and making sure that she had complete control of her diet. She'd heard about maybe Mary T, you know, getting sick. I think I tell that story of Mary T losing like 20 pounds at the world championships. I mean, like, I don't know, 12, 15 seconds off in her 200 fly. Mm-hmm. She was so sick and still won. That's how great Mary T was. But, but you know, so I think maybe she'd heard something like that or she was just going to take full control.
Yeah.
But what I do tell my athletes, that's going pretty far. And maybe, as you said, not taking McDonald's, whatever, any possibility. But I try to tell them not to eat differently, you know, on the race day than they typically eat. Maybe, as you said, maybe a little less or a little different timing, but pretty much the same stuff they're used to. Is that a fair thing to say?
Yeah, for sure.
Chicken sandwiches, eat chicken sandwiches. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you want your body to know what's coming in. And if there's anything different, it could cause some issues GI wise. And just, you might be burping up. You might end up in the bathroom. Like, you do not want any of those situations before race day. Plus you have the added factor of nerves. And there's some cortisol, which is your stress hormone that's elevated before a race. And that can slow down digestion or speed up digestion, depending on the individual. So I mean, if you think of it this way, you train, so your muscles know what to expect, right? You dive into that pool for your A race, your body knows exactly what to expect. You know what speed to go, you know your stroke count, you know everything. Your GI tract is a series of muscles too. So you want to make sure that those muscles are trained to take in what you're going to take in on race day. So it needs to have a perfect execution of digestion of foods, just like your body is perfectly executing your race strategy. Same exact theory. So yes, and that's why nutrition is so important to be consistent with, so that your body knows day in and day out what it's taking in. Now, it's a little different because you don't want to eat the same thing all the time. You want to change it up to some degree so that you're getting in different nutrients and making it work more efficiently. But overall, you're still eating the same types of foods, just in different combinations.
So in our plan, we've already experimented so much with this individual person that, you know, literally every week we could say, hey, you know, how are you performing? I like to do a lot of test sets. I mean, I track everything. So, yeah. So even when they're not doing test sets, if they're kicking and they're in a relay or whatever, they're kicking, I know their threshold for kicking. And when I coach, that's how I coach. So I know the threshold for kicking. So if we throw them at a pyramid, let's say, you know, 100, 200, 300, 400, and then down, I keep a watch out. I'm kind of watching, but we start to see some shifts and everything's working great. And the nutrition was working. Mm-hmm. We don't change that, right? Well, you know, we were talking about having the McDonald's or the preserved foods from a Subway on that race day or some other time when it matters most, but you could actually do it. Trying to do the right thing. I think a lot of parents do this, is it's your race day. So let's get the juicer out. You know, they haven't been getting the juicer out. Let's put some macronutrients into there and something like that. And their kids spending time, you know, we call it number three here, where they're sitting on the pot. You know, they're just a mess. It was a good idea, but you know, you should be doing it. If you're going to try something like that, try it in September, you know, October, November. And then when you're trying to
and be consistent with it. Cause then you're going to, it's like it's best of both worlds. You're going to gain the strength, your body's going to be healthier, your tissues are going to be healthier if you're consistent along the way. That way, race day, you don't have to think about it. You're just doing the same thing, other than kind of, you know, struggling along the way, not giving your body what it needs. And then on race day, you're right, I have athletes like just taking all these vitamins and then it's upsetting your stomach, and because they haven't taken it before, but it's the last effort chance to be healthy. Yeah. Or something. So there has to be consistency in training with nutrition also.
Well, I was that when I was in high school, I didn't know anything. And I was a sophomore, I just started swimming, and on race day, I ate a bunch of honey in the morning, and oh my gosh, I don't even know how I got through it. You know, when I starved, other than that, you know, honey was going to do it.
Right.
But there's so many myths out there that it's funny to just say that. And I tell swimmers that, I'm like, look, I've made these mistakes. I'll tell parents that is, you know, you try to do the right thing, and I get it, but let's start in September. That's why I think between now and September, you and I could come up with a really good, you know, like September issue of my magazine or whatever, just to show, okay, here's your Excel sheet. You may change it up any way you want, but Jennifer and to a small extent, I have said, okay, these are the variables and the other things. If the coach changes those variables, or your sleep changes, or, you know, you're all in AP classes and you weren't before, some things change. These things can kind of change too. And you can even ask us some questions, but see if manipulating those helps by the end of the week, literally not by the end of the season. People are like, I'll throw myself at the season and see whether or not taper works. And everyone goes, when do you begin your taper? How long do you taper your swimmers? And they'll second guess all, because I get a lot of swimmers from a lot of different coaches. You know, coaches, I mean, really good coaches, but
all over the place,
they're second guessing them anyway. And so, and they, in some cases should, because the coach doesn't even know, you know, like their kicking time or their stroke count or whatever, because they got 40 people to work with, you know, or hundreds of people. Yeah. And so, you know, they're second guessing them. And I'm like, you know, look, I start taper in September for the end of short course season. So, but I want to know that it's working on Friday if I start on Monday. So if it took you 22 strokes to get across the pool when in a 500 that we tested you, and that was your average on Monday, on Friday, I'd like to see 21, you know, and I'm going to give you 12 ways to make it lower. And same thing we can do with nutrition is, you know, you came in, you're kind of sleepy by your own account, you're having trouble sleeping, or you're sleeping too much, or you, by your own account, you're overweight, by your own account, whatever, on Friday, are you better? You know, and how do we measure that? So now that leaves it to the pro to do that, not me, you know, and even to the, I do a lot of RPE too, where I actually ask the swimmer the rate of perceived exertion.
Love that, yep.
Is there something in nutrition where we can say the rate of, you know, wellness, rate of perceived wellness or something like that?
Yeah. I love RPE because I just think it connects your mind and your body so much, and you can just keep asking your body questions and really taking a pulse on how you feel. I do a lot with hunger cues. So when regulating our blood sugar, how is your hunger? You know, are you starving? Could you go for a meal? Or, you know, and that really equates to high blood sugar and low blood sugar. If you're really stuffed or really starving or somewhere in between, most of the times that correlates really well to blood sugar regulation. So I do a lot of work with hunger cues, just listening to your hunger cues and related to that, listening to your energy cues. So if you're eating something and it's giving you a lot of energy and your workout is really great, or you felt great through the school day, concentrating in all your classes, if you're a student, then that tells me, okay, we did something right. But on days where you're just, you know, kind of foggy thinking and you couldn't pay attention and maybe weren't hitting your splits in the pool, or maybe a little down, because it's also regulated to our brain chemistry also. So if we have some athletes that just deal with feeling blue or a little bit of mild depression, then that could be, not always, but could be nutritionally related also. So right. I do a lot of asking a lot of questions and then probing them to ask themselves questions throughout the day, so we can figure out how the food that they're eating is relating to how they're feeling physically and mentally.
Do you already have a list of these questions, or you just do that? You've been doing that just one-on-one, right?
I mean, I kind of do have a list. I don't know. Yeah, it's in my head, but I could easily write it down.
Would you mind? You could send me a list.
Yeah, for sure.
Put that into a, you know, like a format that looks kind of good.
Love that.
And maybe even we can, getting my website redone, and maybe we can even have a thing where they can actually, you know, answer it and it shows up within the spreadsheet, but they just answered, you know, along the way.
Right.
We could also, I've been doing this in Excel. I should show you this, but I've got a stroke report card, right? So I went through and broke down every stroke into its components. And you know, you can change it. Again, it's Excel. I like that coaches can change it. And I don't think this is important, that's important. We've been flipping things around about, you know, okay, it's not the fifth stroke underwater. If you're in the pool, it's the first stroke. And so I try to flip that as far as what I'm teaching people to do.
Yeah.
But what I did was, and I so far I've been sort of cheating, is I was going to do all the videos. So backfloat, streamline backfloat, and with a glide, and how far do you go, and stuff like that. And then we give them a score. They give themselves a score of 1 to 5. So we did it that way for years and years. I've been showing that and using that camps and clinics and getting it out to people. People love it. Use it. But now you can take, let's say, you can say, okay, underwater dolphin kick. Are your legs straight? You know, legs straight on the up kick, on the recovery phase of the kick, instead of bending and pulling yourself backwards.
Right.
You can click it and it goes to a movie.
Oh, that's neat.
So it shows you how to build your hip extension ability, right? Mm-hmm. So with this, same thing, hunger cues, what did you eat? Click on what you could have eaten instead. We could be, you and I, actually smart enough to go, okay, this person really likes, you know, this kind of food. And, you know, they like sweet stuff. Who doesn't, right? Okay. So they like sweet stuff. Let's give them their sweet stuff, but make it something that doesn't spike their sugar. You know, help me.
Blood sugar. Yeah.
Well, what's the other side? The insulin.
Insulin. Yep.
Spikes their insulin. Right.
Yep.
For some reason, I couldn't remember insulin. Mm-hmm. And I probably need to keep paying attention to that myself, you know? So yeah, without a blood test, right? And then obviously the next level is the blood test. When we wrote our cool coach, we wrote it so that they could click a button and get 1 million workouts. They would just randomly give them 1 million permutations of workouts. And it was really impressive, except it didn't have anything to do with you. So then you could go to the next level and put your best times in, right? And then your track times, like kicking, pulling, sculling, stroke count, all that. And then it would give you, then you're going to get a workout that actually it would still create, but it would be a lot more about you. Like if you didn't break 130, it wouldn't ask you to go 122, you know? And so you'd read these things in swimming world about how Janet Evans used to train, and people would try to do that, except they weren't Janet Evans. And so, you know, when we adapted, and people would try to adapt the workout, but we would do it based upon the energy spectrum. We'd actually try to give them EN2 or whatever they were trying to do. Yeah. And now people do it a lot, but they still don't understand systemic stress, but you do and I do. So, but that's what nutrition can do. What is it doing? How are you responding? On Monday, after that first week, we can actually help you to be different. We can probably have you different by the end of the weekend, right? You can feel better.
Yeah. I love that, because that's small little snippets that are, they can handle that. They can handle a 1 week commitment. And then the feeling that they're going to get at the end of the week is going to be the motivator to keep that behavior going, because they're going to feel better. So I love that.
Yeah. And you just want to show yourself at the season. You actually do it Monday, the first workout. Yeah.
Right.
That's what we do, stroke count the first time I see somebody.
Yeah. You know, and it's interesting. You just mentioned the systemic stress, which I always think athletes pretty much understand that eating better is going to make them better. And if it's not going to make them better, it's definitely going to make you healthier. So I think most humans kind of understand the connection. I think the connection that they don't understand is that not eating well, not eating the nutrients that they need to eat, or not eating healthfully, can actually hinder their performance, because it's going to create a stress. Poor nutrition creates inflammation. Inflammation is a systemic stressor that is obviously going to hinder your body from being the best athlete it can be, but it can also cause a number of other health consequences. And I think that that's what most athletes don't understand. So they think, I'm young, I'm healthy, I'm a great athlete, I can eat cookies and pizza and beer and it's not going to affect me, but it actually does. So poor nutrition can hinder your performance just as much as good nutrition can excel your performance.
So when you say it's maybe worth 80%, it's, you know, it's funny because if you're, you know, the saying, if you're a hammer, everything's a nail. So as a biomechanist, I'm like, it's all about stroke. And that's, it's funny because I've got people that agree with me in each area. Genetics probably say it's all about training. And he doesn't, he's not one dimensional. He talks a lot about stroke and he measures power actually with a force plate and stuff. So he does some really cool stuff crossing over from what you'd think would be his specialty. Bill Sweetenham said, you know, I don't care how far you go or how fit you are, if you don't have stroke, it doesn't matter, you know. And Steph Curry says, if you don't have a dribble, if you don't have a handle, you really can't shoot, because you're randomly coming up every time. And you might make a basket or two, just like you're saying. You might have a great meet. You might look like you're on top of the world. But when you're really on top of the world, it's not easy to stay there. And if you've got this one thing you're not doing very well, and especially not easy to stay there for a long period of time. Exactly. I would think that the people who do, when you see the Phelpses that lasted, you know, the nutrition was better. Yeah. Now, is it worth, can you do nutrition and no training? But what would you rather do, right? Here's your point, I think. It's a great point to make. Would you rather be healthy with great nutrition, or would you rather be fit and sick? Because I don't think people, like to your point, I don't think people realize you can be fit and sick. You can be fit and nowhere near your potential, but you're still fit as compared to what, right? We've got the sickest country we've ever had. We've got the first generation that's not supposed to outlive their parents in history. We've got the fattest kids ever by far. We've got the highest suicide rate, which I think goes to your point about what effect is it having on you mentally when your blood sugar is off, when you're not getting the right nutrition, when you're getting hyper, when you're trying to make it up with what are these energy drinks? They call them energy. They're not eating energy. Yeah.
Yeah.
So when they're high, you know, they think they
have started on energy drinks.
I want to. I definitely think that's a time for another talk.
Yeah, I know.
So here's our homework, mine as well as yours. If you can give me that list, I just wrote hunger cues and energy cues, because I think we can actually quantify. We can help them to quantify it. It's kind of like you know, as you said, asking them 1 to 10, how much of an effort was that? How hard was that? In this 1 to 10, you're super like hungry all the time, or you're hungry right before your race, or you're not hungry, or you feel sick right before your race, or give me those cues, and then give me the energy cues, and back to your CGI. I love that. You're all CGI. You go back, okay, what was I eating before, you know, the 2 days before I felt awesome. You know,
makes connection. Yep.
And then you make this, as you said, you make the sale for on Friday, you felt so good. On Monday or Saturday, on Friday night, maybe you're even going to party differently. And I'm talking about, you know, maybe older athletes, you know, we're talking about the pros and stuff. You're going to party differently. I used to, before I partied, even when I was living in a fraternity house for a year, I would eat before I'd go to the party.
Smart. So
I didn't have much less chance I was going to eat chips and that kind of thing, you know?
Yeah.
So much better. You know, dance, much better.
That's true. More energy to party.
Yeah, right. Okay, so then let's get back together. When's a good time? Do you think in a week we can do this again?
Yeah, for sure. Awesome. Next Tuesday would be good.
I think that's great. Let's see, what is that date?
Same time, same place. Yeah, 12 o'clock, does that work? Or 9 your time?
9 our time, yes. $4,000 this summer so far because we had to replace our air conditioner. Yeah, that was hard. But you don't go here without an air conditioner. It's gonna be crazy.
Can't survive, right?
Connecticut will cool down pretty quickly, right?
Yeah. Once August comes, it'll be nice. And then September is beautiful.
Yeah. Nothing like the fall.
Yeah.
Well, all right. Well, thank you. It's been awesome. Right.
And
hopefully this will come out great. We'll post it and people will see kind of a little bit. I need to edit more, but yeah. I just don't have a lot of time. So we'll just let people wade through it. And then I think what we'll do in the future is we'll get snippets of these things to kind of answer questions. And then pretty soon, maybe we'll just do them on purpose as a snippet, especially when we get people's, the questions people ask.
Yeah.
I think maybe we ought to have a frequently asked questions sort of thing where you actually physically ask. And then I'm still going to bug you to do this because I saw it once and it was so awesome. Where the guy from Athlean X got in his kitchen and opened his refrigerator and said, this is how I do it. And you're a perfect person to do that since you live the life too.
Yeah. And I do that a lot on social media, like just little meal ideas and snack ideas and that kind of thing. So I'm happy to do that. That's fun.
Well, maybe we can connect that and maybe get people to go to you where your social media is too.
Is that a good idea? Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, because people actually then come to you and pay for you and stuff. So, right?
Right. Yeah. So that'd be much appreciated. Yeah, that'd be great.
Absolutely. Well, you're worth it. You're already helping me. Believe me, I sit here with the sort of a guilt and go, you're right. And Tony Robbins said one time, I don't know if you got it from somebody else, nothing tastes as good health feels.
Yeah.
And I say that a lot around here, but do I do it enough? And that's the thing.
Right. Maybe we can get you motivated to be consistent.
I love your idea of keeping sort of a log online here where we can people say, hey, I felt great. I performed great. I want to keep being great. And so my next meal right after the meet, a lot of times people just trash themselves after the meet. They don't warm down. They don't do the things they need to do. And I know you teach that and preach that, but we need to show them, hey, you know what? You can do it the wrong way. Go right ahead. Because there's 400,000 registered USA swimmers alone, much less triathletes and everything else.
Wow. Yeah.
Those people would love you to trash your diet.
That's a good way to put it. I love that. A little competition.
Exactly. All right. Well, you have a great weekend or great week and great weekend. We'll see you next
week. You too. All right. We'll talk soon.
All right.
Bye.
And I mean.